the unified message of the church has always been, in a sense, exclusive. Jesus himself did not say that he was a way to the Father, but the way. This has always been difficult for some to hear and difficult for some to say, yet it remains true to our faith. But church, this exclusivity in Christ is only half the story. Well, greetings, my strange friends and friendly strangers. Welcome to another installment of Songs We Pray. I trust that the season of Lent is finding you well. Hey, for the next few weeks leading up to Easter, our plan here is to take a look at some songs, some hymns in our songbook that interact quite closely with the themes of this Easter season. We're going to start today with In Christ Alone. This song is a modern hymn in that it is structured in every way, you know, both musically and lyrically as a hymn, but it was composed in 2002 by a couple of UK songwriters, Keith Getty and Stuart Townend. Now, when we've looked in the past at most of the songs we pray, they're modern songs, and there's often like a definitive version, you know, a recording of the song that by a worship leader or a church that we tend to model our own leadings of the song here at Moncton Wesleyan. With hymns by songwriters like this, though, there's usually ends up being just a whole bunch of different takes on it, such that there is no one definitive version. And this is arguably the case with In Christ Alone. But for the most part, when we lead it here, we tend to model our arrangements on a version that was released by the Passion Worship Conferences back in 2013. They added a bridge to it, they kind of straightened out the chords a little bit, and they just generally made it easier to play with the worship team set up, for which I am quite grateful. Thank you, Passion. Thank you. Now, this is a dense song, y'all, lyrically, so I will fight the urge to comment on every single detail. There are just three things, mostly, that I'd like to point out. First, this song certainly does not contain the full biography of Jesus. You know, there's no overt reference to any of his teachings or to any of his miracles, for example. But the song does make reference to three of the biggest milestones in his earthly life: his birth, his death, and his resurrection. It's helpful for us as a church to regularly rehearse these historical events, to pray them aloud together, to remind ourselves that we don't worship an idea or even a conglomerate of ideas, but we worship a person, a personal God. Jesus, one of the three in one, was both crucified and resurrected on actual days, in actual places, in the actual world. Let's not lose sight of that in our prayers, in our worship. Second, this is one of those songs that has a certain phenomenon in it. I'm not sure if there's a name for it, and I don't really have a great option to offer if there isn't, but pretty much every time the third verse of this song rolls around, there's this near universal response that happens at a certain point. Celebration. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave, he arose again. When we hit that last line, people clap, they shout, they act, well, they act as though they actually believe it to be true, which is wonderful. Now, if you've been tracking with us on these videos at all, then you'd know by now that I tend to be kind of an overly analytical person. It's a bit of a thing. So I've often contemplated why people respond that way at this particular point in the song. There are other songs that we pray that make reference to the resurrection, and clap breaks don't seem to systematically break out when we sing those. I have thoughts surrounding why, but here's the truth. I don't think it really matters. Personally, I find those responses to be such faith-building moments. It's as though the faith of those around me goes viral in a good way. You know, it spreads, it's shared, it's a sustaining way. It's helpful to us, it's glorifying to God, so sometimes it's okay just not to know why. All right, thirdly and finally today, we'll end with maybe a bit of a pill to swallow: the word alone. This song highlights one of the Christian values that is increasingly misunderstood by those in the church and unappreciated often maybe by those not in the church: the exclusivity of Christ. In Christ alone, my hope is found. In chapter 4 of the book of Acts, there's this really early story from the life of the church, like real early, like Pentecost happens, and then boom, here we are. So Peter's on his way to the temple. He heals someone in the name of Jesus, as you do, and people freak out about it enough that buzz about town gets him thrown in jail overnight, just so that he can do some splaining to the authorities in the morning. Now, how does Peter try to calm the situation down? You know, how does he try to be quiet and polite and get himself out of this mess? Well, I'm glad you asked. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone that you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." The unified message of the church has always been, in a sense, exclusive. Jesus himself did not say that he was a way to the Father, but the way. This has always been difficult for some to hear and difficult for some to say, yet it remains true to our faith. But church, this exclusivity in Christ is only half the story. The other half is, though our path to hope, to light, to life is in Christ alone, that path is available and extended to all. The Lord is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Or even, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. As much as people in the first century had a hard time coming to terms with the radical exclusivity of Christ, trust me, they also had a really hard time coming to terms with the radical inclusivity of Christ. The same is true for us and for our world today. There's no path to true life that does not eventually have to squeeze us through the cross of Christ. But the way to the cross is so wide and welcoming that people of every race, every gender, every language, they'll make their way there. People who are just like us, people who are nothing like us, and people that we don't even like are all welcome in Christ alone. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. And this is the power of Christ for us all.